But anyway, it's complete nonsense. But why would people be drawn to this? So I have a theory. Maybe it's true. I think there's evidence for it. Maybe it's true. You can tell me what you think. I'm always struck when people talk about the Venus Project or Jacques Fresco or Al Fresco, I think his name is, that they want things to be provided to them basically for free, that they want to not be subject to the market, to competition, to jobs, to salaries, to wages, to any of those things, that they want to be free to explore and to play and to create and have things provided to them. And they don't really know or understand. They just say it's some algorithm, which is, you know, whatever, right? They don't really know how it's provided, but they just want things provided to them. And I think that that's a very real human yearning for that. And I understand where it comes from. This is the world of a child. Right? This is the world of a child. Children should not have to worry about competition or wages or salaries or earning a living or paying taxes or any of those things. They should be free to create and explore, and mommy and daddy provide them resources, and they don't really know where they come from or how they're achieved or what they are. They're just like, I want that toy. Can we afford it? Yes or no? I don't really know what money is or where it comes from. I mean, my daughter sets up pet stores to sell her toys. You know, she'll charge a dime for something expensive and, you know, $5,000 for a tiddlywink piece, right? So in early childhood, this is what the world is. It is this great city where stuff is provided for you and you don't have to worry about being an adult. You don't have to worry about money and jobs and all that kind of stuff. So, and if your needs as a toddler to be shielded from the necessities of adult production and consumption and trade and property and paperwork and contracts, if your need as a child to be shielded from all of that is not met, you will continue to have this yearning and you will be unprepared for the adult life of trade and negotiation and all these kinds of things. And you'll have this yearning. And you probably will want to recreate this fantasy where your needs will be met in the future in order to avoid the pain of your needs not having been met in the past. So I would assume that the people who are drawn to this movement have this yearning for the recreation of a childhood state in the future. And this is why it's so compelling. And this is why reason and evidence don't matter, because it's an emotional yearning that they have. I actually really sympathize with that emotional yearning. I think it's terrible that their needs weren't met when they were babies and when they were toddlers. Because what they're attempting to recreate is the tyranny that results from an attempt to heal a broken history through social engineering in the future. And I think it's really tragic. Socrates said that know thyself, the first commandment, know thyself. Know why you're interested in particular arguments, in particular ideas. Understand what motives have occurred for you. Therapy, I argue, is essential for everybody who wants to talk about reason, truth, evidence, philosophy, ethics, society, whatever, to make sure that your ideological perspective is not serving some unmet emotional need from your childhood. Scientifically, this is how it works. Most people have an emotional impulse, which they then argue after the fact. Now, you probably have noticed that the Zeitgeisters and other people, not just them, but they tend to react with condescension, hostility, and so on when their beliefs are questioned. And that's because when you dismantle an ideology that is an emotional defense for unmet needs in childhood, a lot of pain, panic, anxiety, anger, fear arise. And they then react as if you're scaring them, as if you're making them angry, as if you're alarming them. They react in an aggressive manner because they feel aggressed against, because the illusions that cover the uncomfortable feelings from early childhood are being penetrated. And this is why the facts don't matter. Because the purpose of a ridiculous theory like this is not for truth and evidence and compassion or anything. It's to cover up unmet emotional needs that are very painful. Now, the other thing, so structural violence was talked about a lot, and I think I understand something to do with it. So structural violence is something to do with the structure of society that results in the suffering of people, which is why Peter Joseph wanted to change my meaning from the initiation of force to the infliction of suffering. So hunger is structural violence, poverty is structural violence, and so on. And he said, well, you know, dads will hit their kids because they're poor or they're under financial strain. Marriages break up because of financial strain. Now, if you grew up in a family where finances are a big problem, well, mommy and daddy have to go to work. Well, why do mommy and daddy have to go to work and leave me alone or leave me in a daycare or leave me with people that I don't know? No, they wouldn't leave you alone, but leave you in a daycare or whatever, right? Because of money. And therefore, money is the reason that I was left alone as a child, so therefore I don't like money. You know, mom had to go and work, she had a job, and that's why mommy wasn't there to kiss me and cuddle with me and play with me, right? Because she had a job. Therefore, jobs are bad. The necessity for money, the necessity for jobs is why I didn't have a mommy when I was a baby, and therefore, right? And so what you have to do is you have to say, well, it wasn't my mother's choice that she wasn't with me when I was a baby. It wasn't that she wanted to work, she had to work. And any system which forces people to work basically robs children of their mommies, and that's very painful, and therefore that is systemic violence. And it seems that pretty much you find something negative, structural violence, you find something negative, something that nobody likes, people without health care, people who are poor and so on, and then you say, well, that's structural violence and that's the free market. And so basically it's just finding whatever negative things you can and attaching them to this concept called the free market as a kind of ad hominem. It's not an argument, right? Nobody can say how the free market produces all of these things, given that the rise of human poverty from medieval extreme poverty was the result of the free market. You know, while these guys are off fantasizing about their robot cities and so on, people like myself who are advocating for the free market are helping drive an intellectual movement that has literally raised hundreds of millions of people out of poverty in the last 20 years. Let me say that again. While these guys are dreaming of and pretending they have an algorithm to satisfy all human needs with Star Trek teleporters and crap like that, not getting anything done to actually help the poor, people like myself are advocating for the free market, which in China and India alone, whatever free market has been allowed to grow, has literally lifted hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. It's the biggest escape from poverty that humanity has ever experienced in the history of the planet. And you don't hear about it because, of course, it's about the free market. You can't hear about the free market because you're not supposed to love your chains, right? So I do think it's unmet needs in childhood. It's not a concern for the poor. It's unmet needs in childhood. If you can blame the system, then you can forgive your parents. Then you don't have to blame your parents because it's the structure, it's the system, it's whatever that is causing all these problems. And so if you change the system, but your parents aren't responsible for what they did, for any abandonment or neglect or abuse or whatever it was. They're just victims of the system. And the fact that neither of Peter Joseph's parents were anywhere close to the free market whatsoever would indicate that his problem should more rationally be with statism rather than with freedom, with the free market. But from a child's perspective, right, mommy has to go. Mommy has to go because mommy has a job. Mommy has to have money to pay the bill, so mommy has to go. Oh, money is bad. Money takes mommy away from me, and therefore money is bad. Jobs are bad because they take mommy away from me. It's a child's perspective. And I have huge sympathy for that. Fantasizing about these, you know, big giant electronic teats that will give you all the mother's milk that you want at no cost doesn't solve the problem of the emotional abandonment, neglect, or abuse that most likely these people experience as children. It actually will actually re-inflict it on others. And we don't sort of have to get into the details of that. It's just one last thing, if you appreciate your patience, one last thing I'd like to say, which is this. Peter Joseph had a bad experience in the free market. I've had mostly good experiences in the free market. The difference is that I love the free market and he hates the free market. Because he hates the free market and he hates money and he hates jobs, what kind of employee do you think he is? Do you think he's a fun guy to work with? Do you think he's enthusiastic? Does he show up to work saying, how can I basically help this company? How can I please customers? How can I have a great time at work? No, he resents it. He's grudging towards it. He doesn't like it. And the people that he sucks into this mindset also become shitty employees. Bad at the free market. This idea that we're stuck in these layers, this is class constant, is nonsense. If you're born into the bottom 20% of society, your kids have a 60% chance of getting out of that. And they have a 60% chance, if they get out of it, of going up at least two rungs, right, to the middle class. Society is very flexible. You're up and down. Now, your enthusiasm and your embrace of trade, of markets, of capitalism, of freedom, of all that kind of stuff, has a lot to do with how successful you're going to be, assuming that you don't disappear into the maw of brain-eating government bureaucracies. So these beliefs, these ideas, they do not come without cost. They come with enormous, significant cost. Because I guarantee you, I would never, ever want a Zeitgeister anywhere near my business, because they would be resentful, they would be negative, they would spread negativity, they would drag their feet, they would bitch at everything, they would not want to be there or feel it was unnecessary to be there, or there was this perfect world and I was the man keeping them. Like, you wouldn't want these people anywhere near your business. And that's a huge problem. Because if you hate the market, but in order to consume you have to produce, fact of nature, fact of biology, fact of reality, don't blame me. If you resent it all, and if you hate it all, and if it's, you consider it unnecessary, and then and you're being ground down and oppressed and all this kind of stuff, boy, talk about a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you hate the market will just walk on by. Will just walk on by. And employers will just walk on by. And what happens then is you end up being stuck in shitty, low-rent jobs. Now, when you're at the lowest end of the economic spectrum, you have the worst managers, because any manager who's got any quality is going to, I'm not going to manage a Starbucks or a McDonald's or whatever. Not that they're not fine companies, it's just that I'm more skilled than that. I can manage knowledge workers. I can manage programmers. I can manage a creative team. I've been a director of plays. I can manage actors. I can manage stagehands and stage directors and art directors. I just more skilled as a manager than that. And so when you're working, you know, in a low-rent restaurant or a coffee shop or something, you don't have a good manager, almost by definition. You may accidentally have one as he moves on to something better, but it's going to be pretty temporary. And so if you are resentful, and if you don't acquire the necessary skills and come to work with enthusiasm and positivity and want to get things done and want to make things better for everyone, you're going to get stuck in these low-rent jobs, being exposed to bad managers, and then you know what you're going to say? Wow. Capitalism really is a dead-end and exploitive system. No. That's your belief. That's your self-fulfilling prophecy. That is not what's left of the free market. What's left of the free market will openly embrace and encourage people who provide value to their employers. So it is not a belief system that is consequence-free. I mean, no belief system is consequence-free, but this one is particularly important. Because if you're wrong, right, I say this to the Zeitgeisters, like, if you're wrong, if the free market is a benevolent and beneficent system, if it can provide the greatest opportunity for you to gain the freedom that money can bring and success can bring and autonomy, the autonomy that results in that can bring, and richer people are happier. Statistically, it's almost a uniform trend that the more money you get, the happier you are. Because with more money comes FU money. Right? Nobody can really boss you around and tell you what to do because you have enough money to make choices, to have choices. And so it is not consequence-free. If you believe this stuff and you're wrong, you're condemning yourself to a life of crappiness, which is absolutely statistically unnecessary. So please, if you've got these kinds of childhood, go see a therapist. Work on these issues. I've been to therapy for years. It is mwah, mwah, mwah. I kiss it three times. It's such an amazing thing if you get the right therapist. You can deal with these childhood issues. You don't have to fantasize about robot cities in the future that will give you everything you want. You don't have to try and recreate the perfect toddlerhood at some point in the future, which will never happen. You can actually deal with these emotional issues. You can enter the free market with happiness, joy, confidence, and positivity. Unfortunately, you will have to start giving people responsibility in your life for their moral choices, particularly when you were a child. That's a byproduct of maturing, is the granting of moral responsibility to other people. One of the most significant characteristics of an immature person is that they don't hold people accountable for their decisions, right? So this is why Peter Joseph gets angry at me, but not at, say, dads who abuse their kids, right? Do you understand? Because dads who abuse their kids are part of a structural violence and therefore follow his theory, therefore they're okay. He forgives them and doesn't blame them. But me, who questions and punctures this delusion, he gets angry at me. Right? This is perfectly compatible. Right, but the idea that you get more angry at somebody who's debating you than you would at a guy who's hitting his children is so morally deranged that it can only be that it serves some sort of emotional need. So please, whether you think I'm right or wrong or crazy or not, go see a therapist, deal with these issues, you know, take 6 months, take a year. Maybe you guys are completely right, but please, please make sure that this ideology is not serving some unmet emotional need from your childhood, as almost every person's thinking is. Just look this up scientifically, statistically. Emotional impulses result in intellectual justifications. Almost all moralizing and philosophy is an ex post facto justification for emotional problems. And if you've been to therapy and if you've done the work, by God, you can be free of that stuff and really think clearly and rationally, not be defensive, not be hostile, not be resentful. And it will give you the chance for success. It will give you the chance to overcome the challenges of your own history and the deprivations or abuses that it probably contains. So I urge you, don't assume that it's true. It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, and it will drag you down or keep you down in the dregs of the low-rent market system, which is not where you want to be. You guys are too smart for that. You're too verbally acute for that. So please, please, just think about it. Think about calling up a therapist, or at least think about picking up some workbooks. Nathaniel Brandon's got great stuff. John Bradshaw has some pretty good stuff. Just think about the journey of self-exploration, the journey of understanding your own history, so that you can be free of any ex post facto intellectual justifications for emotional problems, which is almost universally the norm in humanity. And I've not seen anything in this debate or in the responses to it on my previous two conversations about this to indicate that the Zeitgeisters are free of this almost universal phenomenon of using the intellect to evade the emotion. So I hope that helps. Thank you so much for your patience and attention. I will talk to you soon.